Good morning, church. Good morning.
Good morning.
What a beautiful day. Happy Mother's Day to all those in the sanctuary and all those that are watching. And just a special shout out to my mother this morning. Mom, happy Mother's Day. I love you. I wish I was there with you. And hope to see y'all soon. But I am so thankful, church, for Jesus.
Amen.
This morning I just meditate upon the Lord. Right at daybreak and just thanking him for his goodness, his mercy, his love, all wrapped up in Calvary, all wrapped up in the cross, that we need not fear because it is a finished work and we are his children. The Psalm of David, 139, verse 7, digest this carefully in your spirit this morning, 139 and 7. Where shall I go from your spirit? Or where shall I flee from your presence? And I thank God that we can never flee from his presence.
Right,
that we can never outrun the Holy Spirit.
Yeah.
That's a two-edged sword now. He's an all-seeing God. But I thank the Lord as his children. He's always got a watchful eye on us. That nothing can happen to the child of God without his approval. David would go on to say, if I take the wings of the morning and dwell in the uttermost parts of the sea, even there, oh, I love that, even there shall your hand lead me, and your right hand shall hold me. I will praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Marvelous are your works, and that my soul knows right well. I will praise him, church. I will thank him, because he did not have to step out of the portals of glory. He could have created us and said, you have turned your back on me one too many times. How many times have we seen that in families? But that type of agape love will never turn his back on his creation.
Amen.
And his creation will just look up and say, Lord, help me.
Yes.
That's all it takes. Lord, help me. You are our only hope this morning. He's been our only hope. He will be our only hope, church. If we can just grasp just a little bit of that. If Jeremiah would say, cursed is the man. Cursed, what a terrible word. Cursed is the man who makes his trust in flesh, making his strength his right arm. Meaning strength is in your right arm according to the word of God. But blessed is the man who trusts in the Lord.
Amen.
Blessed, that means today, tomorrow, for eternity. Amen.
Amen.
Do you love the Lord this morning?
Amen.
Glory to God. Heavenly Father, we come before you. Your children gathered together on this Mother's Day, 2022. We love you, Father. We thank you, Lord, for your many, many blessings. Oh, that day at Calvary. As we look back to Calvary, we live Calvary daily. As we take up our cross daily and follow Jesus. We thank you, Lord, for that atoning work, for that blessing work, for that justification work, for that sanctification work, for that work is eternal. And we thank you for that today, Lord. We ask, Lord, for your Holy Spirit to take over this service, to drench our hearts and drench our minds this morning. Where can we go from your Spirit? Where can we go from your presence? We ask, oh Lord, for you to take over as Jesus is head of this church. Anoint us, oh God, to draw closer to you as we praise thee today. We ask all these things. In the Master's name of Jesus, amen.
Amen.
And amen.
Come on, guys. Praise the Lord. Let's just stand and pray.
Yes, yes, yes.
The Lord is here today.
Yes.
Come on, church.
Hallelujah.
What a fellowship. Thank you.
being stripped away.
Yeah.
I could talk to them again, you know?
Yeah.
I said, this is a sentimental time. This is a little sentimental song that I heard Brother Terry Terrell sing. And it's not biblical. But it, on this Mother's Day, I think it's appropriate to call it, There's a Phone in Heaven. Put my mama on the line. Jesus. Well, good morning, Jesus. Yes, it's me, love you. But I didn't call. I know she's there with you. There's a phone in heaven that Jesus put me through. Give me one more chance to tell her that I love her.
Before that, when she was sick, she went to church with me. And I had the privilege. to pray. But a voice inside kept asking me, did I think God was really listening to anything that I had to say? But I just kept right on a praying, holding on by faith, knowing God is always in control. And I waited like a rosebud in the garden, for only God can unfold the rose. When God unfolds the rose, He always gets it right. When the petals are in place, it's such a beautiful sight. God knows when to hold on, and the perfect timing to let go. So let God have His way, and watch God unfold. There are trials and tribulations we must all go through. When it comes to heartache, we've all had our share. But when times are the hardest, we must hold God to His promise. He said He'd never give us more than we could bear. So I'll just keep right on a praying, holding on by faith, knowing God is working all things for my good.
Yes, He is.
And I'll wait like a rosebud in the garden. When God unfolds, this song means so much to me. When I look at a rose, I think of my mom. She loved roses. And when I look at that rosebud, that's like a little child that's been born. And as we grow up each day, each petal opens up as we grow in God. Growing in the Spirit and in the truth.
Yes.
I feel like God put those roses here for a purpose. And if you look at them and know that in the beginning you was just a bud, but as God unfolds you each and every day, each petal falls out. And it makes such a beautiful, beautiful sight.
Yes.
It's a beautiful rose.
Yes.
Like the rose of Sharon. He was the rose of Sharon.
Yes. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Oh, hallelujah. I see the order of the Lord. Yes, hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. I see the order of the Lord. I see the order of the Lord. I feel like I had the best mom in the world, and I miss her every day, Marion. I haven't even cleaned her room out. Every time I say I'm going to, I can't do it. And I still call it Mama's room, and Mama's bed, and Mama's this, and Mama's that. She was so special to me. And after after she lived with me for so long. I mean, I see her still in her chair. We drank coffee together every morning before I go to work. We drank coffee together every evening and watched Andy Griffin. And those days are gone. And you want to tell these kids that have a mama still to love them while you have them. Because when they're gone, they're gone. I talk to Mama. I have her little garden in my front yard. I made her a little rose garden out there. And I've got things in there for her. And I go out there a lot of times and I just talk to her. And I know, as that phone's in heaven, Brother Fletcher, I know there's a line that reaches God. We reach God, and I know that they hear us. And our tears, and they see our tears. But I love each and every one of these mothers. All of you. But if you have your mom, which I know most of us don't, the greater you do, you love your mama while you can.
Well, I too think I had the best mom in the whole world. So, and I would do anything to have one more conversation with her. So yes, if you do have your moms, enjoy them. This is actually for Brother Mark.
Bible says, train up a child in the way they should go, and when they are old, they shall not depart from it.
Amen.
They shall not. So those of you that are mothers that are watching or here, and you may be deeply concerned about the spiritual welfare of the children and grandchildren, if they have been brought up correctly, if they've been brought up to follow Christ Jesus, they have been taught the right way, you continue to reinforce what has been taught continually in prayer,
yes.
Supplication,
yes,
before the throne of Almighty God. Just because your mother is not here this morning, understand this, that the prayers that she set up for you are still going up before the throne. If they have not been completely answered, church, well, I don't feel that this morning. For all things work together for good to them who love God and are called unto His purpose. In those prayers of whether it's a father or a mother or whoever it may be, church, sometimes it takes a lifetime to get a prayer answered. Come on. Because it's not His fault, it's us. We're the problem. Mankind is the problem. Our stubbornness, our pride. And yes, unfortunately, the love of sin in this world. But a pleading mama, pleading the blood of Jesus. Talking about Swaggart Records. I was raised on that too. 33 and a third albums with the red label with Jim in the middle. We had just a little cheap record player. But I remember listening to song after song after song that Mama would listen to, that Mama would just sing to. And it just permeated the whole house with the Holy Spirit.
Right.
I can remember that as a child walking in. And then I didn't think much of it, you know. I was a little rebellious boy. Some boys are. But in looking back, I can sense now in my mind's eye that the Spirit was present in our home. And I thank God for that today. I thank God for godly mothers today. Does anybody else have a testimony that they'd like to share this morning? We've already had two about mothers. Is there anybody else? You want to say something about your mother? Or anything else for that matter? I guess we've had three, not four. Anybody else?
Wednesday night, anytime I had things for the seniors or whatever. But
the book of 2 Corinthians, Paul's second letter to the church at Corinth. You can keep your seat this morning because I'm going to read quite a few verses. 2 Corinthians chapter 4. We're going to begin reading at the very first verse and go all the way through the 12th verse. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, beginning at verse 1. Paul, incidentally, while you're getting your place, Paul would write this second letter in either 64 or 65 AD. Historians tell us he was concerned because he had sent the first letter with Titus to Corinth. Titus did not return. Paul was getting a little shaky, a little panicky. So Paul crossed over into Macedonia. There he met Titus, finally. He was concerned that the first letter would not be received well and was worried about the condition of the church, but Titus assured him that they were embracing the message of grace, the message of the cross, the preaching of the cross. And then Paul would follow up now with a second letter that he would write, historians tell us, from Macedonia. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 1. Therefore, seeing we have this ministry, as we have received mercy, we faint not, but have renounced the hidden things of dishonesty, not walking in craftiness, nor handling the word of God deceitfully, but by manifestation of the truth, commending ourselves to every man's conscience in the sight of God. But if our gospel be hid, it is hid to them who are lost, in whom the God of this world has blinded the minds of them which believe not, lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine unto them. For we preach not ourselves, but Christ Jesus the Lord, and ourselves your servants, for Jesus' sake. For God, who commanded the light to shine out of darkness, has shined in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. But we have this treasure in earthen vessels, that the excellency of the power may be of God and not of us. We are troubled on every side, yet not distressed. We are perplexed, but not in despair. Persecuted, but not forsaken. Cast down, but not destroyed. Always bearing about in the body of the dying of the Lord Jesus, that the life also of Jesus might be made manifest in our body. For we which live are always delivered unto death for Jesus' sake, that the life also of Jesus might be made manifest in our mortal flesh. So then death works in us, but life in you. Glory to God. I want to use for a subject this morning. For us, in us, and through us. For us, in us, and through us. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we come to you humbly before the throne in the name of Jesus. Lord, we ask for the Spirit's anointing to rightly divide the word of truth this morning, for a message that I believe that you've given unto us, this body, for this hour, this time. Lord, we must have the anointing on our hearts that we will be able to receive what the Spirit desires to give. We ask all these things that in Jesus' name, and that you may be glorified, you may be magnified this morning, and that we will draw closer to you. Again, in Jesus' name, amen and amen. For us, in us, through us. The Lord gave me this title this morning, early. And I did not understand at the moment, but I believe I do now. There's three S's, church, that follow. For us, in us, and through us. Three S's. For us was salvation. God didn't do it for himself. God became man. He became incarnate. He came from heaven, went to the cross, and died for you and me. For us. Salvation. In us. The second S. Sanctification. Meaning that after we come to Christ, we are born again, we are in him, he is in us, we are the temple of the Holy Spirit. Now the Spirit can begin to move and change us into the image of God, into the likeness of Christ, to be more Christ-like. That is exactly what sanctification speaks of, to be set apart from the world, the old self, the old man, and walk in the Spirit by faith. Third one, through us, the last S is service. You have salvation, you have sanctification, and you have service. The last two are perpetually, should be working in you and I. If you're a child of God this morning, whether in the sanctuary or watching, your salvation is secure in Christ Jesus. Your faith is in him, his precious blood. You are saved. And the Holy Spirit constantly is doing a work in you. It is a daily work. It's an hourly work. It will never cease on this side of glory until we get home individually or corporately. And then, of course, service. If we love the Lord like we say we do, then we, each one of us, have a calling or calling. Gifts that are God-given, given to you and I for his service, his kingdom, his glory. Not ours. It's God-given. Yes, we work hard at our craft, the Bible says. A workman, study to show thyself approved. Once the gift is given, the Holy Spirit resides in us to urge us, to lead us, guide, and direct. But the rest of it is, Lord, I will surrender to the calling. I will. It's just a willing mind, church. That's what you give the Lord, is a willing mind and obedient heart. That's all we can give him. And you will if your faith is properly placed. If the object of your faith is correct, it's in Christ, what he did at Calvary's cross, understanding that the resurrection was a testimony to the world that the sacrifice was accepted by God. You're saved. You know it. I do not believe certain preachers when they talk about you can lose your salvation like that. No. I don't care who tells you that. It doesn't work that way. Faith So many today are those saying that you can be saved today and lost tomorrow, and then flip-flop. My salvation is a little more secure than that.
Sister. Amen.
I know in whom I have believed, and I have committed it unto him until the day, meaning the day that he comes and gets me, either corporately or individually. I've committed everything unto God. And our faith is in him, not man, not what man says, but what his word tells me. Amen. This past Thursday, those of you that get my text of the daily scripture, I reminded us all that it was the National Day of Prayer, if you will recall. I'm going to take you back down memory lane to our former president, Ronald Reagan. Full disclosure, I did vote for the man. President Reagan in 1984 would say this at the National Prayer Breakfast. He would say this. He would talk about the courageous Christians who suffered persecution in the Roman Colosseum. He would say this, and I quote, "This power of prayer can be illustrated by the story that goes back to the 4th century. The monk named Telemachus, living in a little remote village, spending most of his time in prayer. One day he thought he heard the voice of God telling him to go to Rome. Weeks and weeks later, he arrived at a time of a festival in Rome. He followed a crowd into the Colosseum. And then, there in the midst of this great crowd, he saw the gladiators come forth, stand before the emperor, and say, 'We who are about to die salute.'" And he realized they were going to fight to the death for the entertainment of the crowd. He cried out, "In the name of Christ, stop." And his voice was lost in the tumult there in the great Colosseum. He continued, and as the games began, he made his way down through the crowd and climbed over the wall and dropped to the floor of the arena. Suddenly the crowds saw this scrawny little figure making his way out to the gladiators and saying over and over again, "In the name of Christ, stop." And they thought it was part of the entertainment. And at first, they were amused. But then when they realized it wasn't, they grew belligerent and angry. Reagan added, and as he was pleading with the gladiators, "In the name of Christ, stop," one of them plunged his sword in his body. And as he fell to the sand of the arena in death, his last words were, "In the name of Christ, stop." And suddenly, a strange thing happened. The gladiators stood looking at this tiny form lying in the sand. The silence fell over the Colosseum. And then someplace up in the upper tiers, an individual made his way to an exit and left, and the others began to follow. And in the dead silence, everyone left the Colosseum. That was the last battle to the death between gladiators in the Roman Colosseum. Never again did anyone kill, or did men kill each other for the entertainment of a crowd. Reagan ended. One tiny voice that could hardly be heard above the tumult. In the name of Christ, stop. It is something we should be saying to each other throughout the world today. President Reagan would say, in the name of Christ, stop. Church, that is powerful. Very, very powerful. That should stir your heart this morning. And if it doesn't, you better check your heart. Here we have, from the time the first century church through the fourth century, you've got gladiators killing Christians, killing each other for sport, lighting Christians on fire for lampposts in the streets of Rome. Century after century after century. Martyrs for the cause of Christ. They would not surrender their testimony. They would not back down. They would go forth in the face of certain death. 11 out of the 12 apostles, I studied it again yesterday, were martyred. The only one we believe historians tell us that was not martyred was John the Revelator. He was finally delivered from the Isle of Patmos, and he lived out his final days in Ephesus. But the other ones were all martyred, including Paul. The Bible talks about being a witness. Now you and I think of as witness, we're witnesses for Christ. And I remember in the Royal Rangers, as a scouting group, the Assemblies of God that I was in, we were to witness to other boys about Christ. That was one of the decrees. But in the book of Acts, the witness part is not talking about verbally or showing that we're a child of God, per se. Witness in the Greek means martyr. You should be witnesses unto me in Judea, Samaria, the uttermost parts of the earth. But no one can do anything to a child of God unless God says it's okay. In other words, those men and women's ministry could not be stopped. Their lives could not be stopped until the ministry was over. When it run its course, Paul would say, I have finished my race. I have finished my course. I'm ready to be offered up. Last week, we talked about this as briefly Tuesday at prayer meeting. Samuel Alito, Justice, Supreme Court Justice Samuel Alito's opinion was leaked. An inside job from the Supreme Court leaked to the press. As of right now, according to the letter, it's about a 5-3 decision to overturn Roe versus Wade. In other words, denying that it's a federal right and it needs to go back to the states for individual ratification, either thumbs up or thumbs down. It's where it should have been all along. It was a bad mistake in 1973. In my opinion. And this person broke the law, has basically thrown their career away when they are found out, to alert about half of America that stands for murder in the womb, and I'm not going to call it abortion, I'm going to call it murder. It's murder, can I get an amen? It's murder! Tired of people calling it a fetus. It's a human being. Even President Biden still got enough sense the other day to he would say, and I'm paraphrasing, but it's the right of a child of God to be able to abort a child. It's the right of a child of God to be able to murder. It's not what my Bible says, it's yours. Deceived, church, deceived. Today, there are many churches under siege today. Mother's Day. As these abortion groups have went out over the country. I'm surprised. Matter of fact, it will not surprise me. We turn on our news later if there's not one group up in Monroe. Assuming there's a church up there that stands against abortion. I have no idea. But across the nation, you can see it unfolding on social media. They spray painted several Catholic churches. My body, my choice, and all types of foolishness. That would have never happened years ago. The persecution is coming. You better hear me today. It's time to get the big boy pants on, so to speak, spiritually. It's time to take that armor. The breastplate of righteousness is occurring around us. Take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit in our hand and say, thus saith the Lord.
Amen.
Amen. It's been a scourge on this nation. The figures are anywhere between 50 and 63 million, depending upon who you talk to, that have been killed over since 1973 until recently. But to lay siege to a church, to spray paint filth on a church, and on the day of all day, Mother's Day. No, and I'm not going to call them a mother, a birthing person. That's what one party calls them now. They don't call them a mother anymore. Birthing person. Idiots. It's a mother!
Yes.
The pulpit, we as Christians have got to stand for something, church.
Right.
We're losing this nation.
Yes.
Right.
And I know I'm probably making some people angry.
Good.
But somebody's got to say, thus saith the Lord.
Yeah, exactly.
Somebody's got to do it. Somebody's got to stand for truth. The next thing that this administration did, they've incorporated now a ministry of truth. That's what they call it. They've got an Einstein running it too. This lady's a piece of work. Ministry of truth, or a department against misinformation. Ministry of truth to comb through, I don't care what they tell you. It is beginning stages of censorship for things they don't like because Elon Musk has taken control of Twitter. That's exactly why, don't be deceived, that's exactly why the same week that Elon Musk buys Twitter, then they create this foolish department. It is an attempt to go after and censor. And once it starts, church, they will come after the pulpit. They will come after that camera, and they will censor us what we can sing, what we can say, what we can preach, and what we can teach. Can I get an amen in this house? I will not stand for it as long as I got breath. I will not, church. Men and women of God, we are soldiers. The Lord tells us, be strong in the power of His might.
Yes.
Paul talks about power. The early church had power. It is time for us believers as children of God to tap into His power. Not ours. It's all about Him.
Yes.
It's His strength. It's His lead. It's His guiding. It's His direction. Our programs in the church have failed. The I say it. We have went from excessive legalism to excessive liberalism. From legalism, come on. You have been in the church for a long time like I have, know what I'm talking about. Excessive legalism. Now to excessive liberalism. The church is looking just like the world. God's not going to tolerate it much longer. He is looking for his true children to stand up and be counted.
Yes.
Amen.
Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. We've been praying for so long, asking the Lord to overturn Roe versus Wade. And we're at the precipice now of it taking place. And I believe it's going to happen. But let me tell you, I know y'all hate him, many, but I thank President Trump. Those three Supreme Court justices. They may not always rule the way I would like them to rule. I stand with the court on this decision, and I stand with my Catholic brothers and sisters. I applaud you. The three that are on the Supreme Court are Catholic faith, by the way. I may disagree with them in a lot of theological circles, but in this, we're 100% together. Let me tell you what this is going to happen, I believe. When it's overturned as a federal right, it is going to go back to the states. God is not going to allow you, I, anybody, to hide behind a cloak of something. What is done in secret shall be revealed openly. They, at the state level, are going to have to stand up and be counted.
That's right.
Every single state legislature, the state senators and the state congressmen and the governors are going to have to stand for life or death.
Right.
I don't care what state it is. California, Oregon, Washington State, Illinois, maybe a few others will probably vote unlimited. I hope I'm wrong. It's like we talked about the other day about sheep and goat nations. We studied this in Revelation. There are going to be sheep and goat states in the eyes of God. There's going to be some that says, no, we don't want it in our state. Watch God bless that state.
Yeah. Yeah.
You hear me today? God, our God is a God of life, not death. And He will stand and bless that state. And all the powers of hell are going to come against it. There's no doubt about it. That's why these agents, whether they realize it or not, they are being used by Satan. When you stand outside of church, you're not protesting the Catholic Church like you think you are, or a Protestant church. You're not protesting a priest or a pastor like people think they are. You're protesting God. Because you're going against His word. You're saying, no, God, I want the right to murder. My body, God, lay off of it. There's the Creator. You see, they have no fear of God. They have no fear of God whatsoever. Only a fool says in his heart, there is no God. And that's what we're dealing with, church. In the hour in which it's come down to, in the lateness of the season, God is saying, okay, stand up and be counted one way or the other. Church, you've heard me say this, and I believe it. I want to expound on it in a minute about a harvest. Things look bad. That's what Paul is saying here. Oh, we get knocked down. We don't stay down. He was dealing with a situation that again, we're studying this on Wednesday night in the book of Romans. But Corinth was doing the same thing too in the Judaizers. Law of grace, law of grace, law of grace. And Paul, bless his heart, I Lord's ever produced a finer Christian than that man right there. I want to have a good conversation with the Apostle Paul. It was times torn on the man. But he said, I know how to be abound or abased. They would follow him and do everything they could. Satan did to try to destroy his ministry, the persecution that that man went through. I don't have the words to describe after I've studied the book of Acts and then Paul's, what we call the Pauline epistles. But he stood firm. He stood firm. And he would say, we faint not. In the face of the persecution, we faint not. We've got, with everything that's going on in America today, you see the news. But it wasn't right in Corinth either. You hear me? Harvest came to Corinth Thursday night. Had a dream. And I knew it was from the Lord. I was preaching. Some people didn't believe me, some did. And I was quoting Brother Jimmy Swaggart, and I'm going to quote him again because I believe the dear brother's right in this respect. He said the Lord told him this, or believes the Lord told him this. And it's what theologians and biblical scholars call the law of double reference. The law of double reference, meaning that there is a reference point at the time of it happening, but it can be used in reference for a later time. That's called the law of double reference. There are many passages in scriptures that fit that. He was praying. And he said the Lord began to deal with his heart on Pharaoh and Joseph. You remember the story. I preached on it many times. Of the dreams of Pharaoh. Joseph had interpreted dreams of a butler and a baker. Told the butler in 3 days, Pharaoh's going to set you free. You'll be back as his royal cupbearer. Baker came to him and said, sorry, pal, in 3 days you're dead. They're going to hang you. What a news. But the butler in a later time remembered that Joseph interpreted his dream, actually both dreams, correctly. Pharaoh was troubled in his mind. He had two dreams. He went to his magicians, his astrologers, the soothsayers. He went to these men. Interpret this. I'm troubled. None. His witchcraft. None. Could interpret Pharaoh's dreams. You remember the two dreams of Pharaoh. Seven. Healthy. Cattle. Seven. Sick. Thin. Cattle. Seven. Grains of corn. Healthy. Seven. Unhealthy stalks of corn. The unhealthy corn would rise up, eat the healthy corn. The unhealthy cattle would rise up out of the Nile and eat the healthy cattle. What in the world? Joseph would interpret it, saying, these dreams are one. They mean the same thing. 7 years of plenty. 7 years of famine. 7 years of plenty. 7 years of famine. Church, as the Lord, Brother Swaggart, believes, and I believe too. I've told you that I believe that we're close to a harvest time. First, I want to talk about the famine. The famine in Pharaoh's time was necessary changed his name from Jacob to Israel. It brought the famine. The 7 years of famine brought Israel and the tribes to the type of Christ, Joseph. So the law of double reference is, it happened then. Now that 7 years is talking about the great tribulation period. Glory to God. So what's going to happen is, when famine hits, peril comes. 12 tribes of Israel. Does that ring a bell? We just studied it in Revelation. 12,000 times 12,000 is 144,000 Jews. Almost immediately when we say 12,000 from each tribe, the 12 tribes that came from glory, from Canaan back to Egypt to see Joseph, they will do that in the tribulation. They will cry out to the Lord Jesus Christ then and recognize, glory to God, will recognize Him as Messiah. Glory to God. The 7 years of plenty. The time of Joseph. He's put in charge. He's the second highest authority in all the world. Pharaoh, that was the greatest country in the world of that day. Joseph, they begin to get busy. God poured out blessing after blessing after blessing because why? Joseph was in charge. A type of Christ. They were looking to Him. The powers that be, remember, these are Gentiles now, just like we are. Ooh, I feel that. Turning it over to a Jew. Ooh, glory. Turning it over. Whoa, whoa, I feel that right now. Turning it over to Joseph. Joseph would build granaries, silos, everywhere in Egypt. They were everywhere. And they would fill them one after another, after another, after another, after another. The harvest coming into the granaries. But you had to build the granary for the harvest. You had nowhere to store the harvest. There was too much harvest. So they had to build these granaries. Brother Swaggart said the other day, and I agree with the dear brother, this is a granary. Oh, come on, somebody. This is a granary. This right here, church, this is a silo that God has prepared. Number one, the physical granary and the small harvest that's in here, He is doing a work in us. That way, when the fresh harvest comes in off that street, we don't contaminate them. Come on! The apostate church, He's not going to send people to an apostate church. Their flesh may send them there. They may enjoy all that foolishness. But the Spirit of the living God is going to send them where they can be fed. And in the time frame, church, that we're living in right now, God is separating the wheat from the chaff. He's getting out the sinful dross in every one of us. Come on. Every one of us. For us. Salvation. In us. Sanctification. This in us that God is working on is that we recognize there's no hope other than Him. There was no hope for Egypt other than Joseph. No hope! None! They would have all died during the famine if it hadn't have been for Joseph. They would have died, Brother Ronnie. They would have perished. But as Joseph would say to his brothers, stepped down in the Roman Colosseum. In Christ, stop. I say the same thing. In Christ, stop. You have no authority over me. You have no authority over the true church. You have no authority over the child of God. We have power that we're not plugging into, church. We've got to plug into the Holy Spirit and say, oh God, help us, help us, help us. We have failed in our flesh. Our flesh is no good. Nothing good dwelleth in me, Lord said. Nothing dwelleth in me that's good. He is the one that's holy. He's the one that's righteous. We've got to get ready. And I know the trials and tribulations, we sing about them. And they hurt. And they're painful. But as I sent out Friday from the book of Ephesians, God is coming back for a glorious church.
Amen. Yes.
Without spot, without wrinkle. He's coming back for a glorious church. And the foolishness that's going on today in much of what is called church, he ain't coming back for that. He's coming back for a harvest out there that is sown to the world. But what would Paul say as we worship? Mercy. Mercy. I get through every day by our merciful God. And there are people out there, Brother Fletcher, that have heard the truth. They have rejected it. I believe the Spirit is going to move and move in a mighty way and direct those that are truly hungry and thirsty. Alcohol's not done it. Drugs have not done it. Relationships haven't done it. Money's not done it. The bright lights haven't done it. You see in there, it talks about light and darkness, what we read. Satan, Jesus said, be not ye there confused. And I'm paraphrasing. Satan is transformed as an angel of light. They're following a false light, Sister Marion. They're deceived. That's what Paul's talking about. They're deceived. We wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers and spiritual wickedness in high places. Those people are deceived that would storm a church. They're protesting God Almighty. They can protest me all they want. Am I your enemy? Because I tell you the truth. You see, for approximately half of this nation, yeah, I guess we are the enemy. Dear brother, in Baton Rouge the other day, listened to a radio show. This radio show was saying, the reason why Roe versus Wade is going to get overturned, she was mad. She was angry. It's because the evangelicals put Donald J. Trump in office. I say amen. She was angry. She said the only way we've got to take down the evangelicals. The church, you listen to me. Paul's talking about persecution. I was reading the other day in French Guiana. A storm of people burned the church and killed the pastor. I was also reading, it was backdated to 2016, a report by the British broadcasting company BBC that in 1 year over 90,000 Christians were martyred. Church, we better wake up. Over 90,000 Christians were martyred. My heart aches today for the families that are left behind, not for the ones that were martyred. They're home with Jesus. That's what y'all are talking about, some of your moms today that went home. You missed them. Let me tell you something, church. You're going to see them again. And this time, death will not separate you. they're safe. You're going to see them again. Paul, and I believe he's talking about here that we are perplexed. But we're persecuted, he says. But we're not forsaken. We're cast down, but not destroyed. In other words, you get kicked. The more you allow, now this don't sound right, but it's biblical. The more you allow the Holy Spirit to take control over you, the harder you're going to get kicked. Satan is going to do everything he can to stop your ministry. Whether it's tomatoes, I don't care what the ministry is. If you're witnessing, you are testifying, you are sharing God's love, His forgiveness. When you're sharing the cross, you are in the crosshairs of Satan.
Amen.
Now thank God that He's on a leash, proverbially speaking. As great is He that is in you than He that is in the world. We need not fear. We need not fear, church. He's going to huff and puff and do whatever he can. He ain't blowing this church down. This belongs to Jesus. When we dedicated this, we dedicated it to God. We didn't dedicate it to ourselves. When we planted a seed of money, it was the Lord who gave us the seed in the first place. The only thing we did, we said, here, Lord, take our first fruits. It's yours. It belongs to you. Now you do with it what you will. And now, it's a granary. That's exactly what I want you to think of this little church building is. It's a granary that God is going to use. He's already using it through social media. But He is going to use it in a powerful way. Because unlike the minister of truth of the White House and the agency, Mr. President, whoever, minister of truth, Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by Him. The Bible says Jesus is truth, the Holy Spirit is truth, the Word is truth, and the anointing of the Holy Spirit is truth. Everything else, no. That's truth. God help us to stand for something. If we don't stand for something, that means you'll fall for anything. That's a true statement, unfortunately. But I know this. His word cannot lie to us, church. God is incapable of telling a lie. The world is full of it. Lies and lies and more lies. Jesus said Satan was a liar from the beginning. He's the father of it. He is the father of lies. And as I get ready to close, for we which live, let me just back up verse 10, always bearing about in the body the dying of the Lord Jesus, that the life also of Jesus might be made manifest in our body. The only way is for Christ to take over, to allow the Holy Spirit to continue to burn the dross out. Things that are not pleasing to God. Things you may not even think about. This in us, we have for us, we're saying, in us, God is continually doing a perpetual work to get things out of us that are not pleasing through us. That's the service. We're called to share. Jesus is the speaking, this is the way God sees you and I that are in Christ. Paul would say this in Galatians chapter 2, verse 20. I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, yet not I. But Christ lives in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. I do not frustrate the grace of God, for if righteousness come by the law, then Christ is dead in vain. Give the Lord a big bow of praise. It's all in him, church. It's Christ that lives in you. It's not you and I. It's Christ that's living in us. It's the Spirit of the living God working in us. Therefore, now that he's working in us constantly, now, you see, think about this. And this is exterior, but you'll get it. I'm going to get in trouble when I say this, but anyway. You sisters that wear makeup. And no, it's not a sin to wear makeup. Certain Pentecostal holiness people, it's not a sin to wear makeup. The exterior, you're doing something. You can see a change when you look in the mirror. Same thing internally. The work the Holy Spirit is doing in you, the process of sanctification, should be an outward mirror. What comes out is what is inside you. And then they will see, they should, Christ-likeness. A mirror, if you will. They will begin to see Christ. In other words, the fruit of the Spirit is being evidenced outward. We have the work that's coming in. Let me tell you something, church. Some people may say I'm too emotional of a preacher. Song, it is my desire. If you knew where Jesus brought me from, and where I am today, you'd shout too.
Amen.
When you get so full of the Holy Spirit, this being you, me, we're an earthen vessel. We just read it. That's all we ever will be on this earth, is an earthen vessel. We're made out of clay, so to speak, from the ground, from the dust of the ground. It's the Spirit that gives life. When you get so much Jesus in you, it's got to come out. The lid's going to have to pop. The lid's going to pop. You're going to get so hot for the Lord, the Holy Spirit moving in you, burning up the drugs, you got to tell somebody. And those that you don't tell, just you being there, they're going to know something's going on. Because what did we read in Psalms of David? Where can I go that your Spirit does not go with me? Where can I go from your presence? And now, if Christ is in me, his love, his joy, the fruit of the Spirit is coming through me. His presence. His presence. Not mine, not yours. His presence coming out will touch other people.
Right.
Will touch other people.
Right.
Church, clock is ticking. He's getting his church ready. Brother, can you come? He's getting his church ready. The ones that saved, that love him. Not hypocrites. Not coming to church just for a fellowship and a good old time. No, we're coming to learn to grow in the grace and knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. We may be few and far between, but it don't take much for God, does it?
Amen.
It don't take much for God. Woo! It just took one. One in the Colosseum. In Christ, stop. In the name of Christ, stop. I want us to pray. Seek the Lord this morning. The harvest is coming. But number two, is our grain ever ready?
salvation. And we thank you for that. We're justified. Oh, I love him for that, I thank you. But again, the process of working in us, sanctification is ongoing. Are we yielding to the Spirit so the Spirit can produce more fruit out of us? To get the granary ready to receive, you see, because, real quick, when I was in plastics years ago, we had silos. There's a granary. It was a silo. And we would pump different materials in there. But if the first part of the material is bad, and we pumped more material on it, we had to drain the whole silo. And then send it out and have it reworked. All the effort wasted, lost, time, resources. Meaning this, God is not going to send fresh grain, fresh harvest into a tainted house. He ain't going to do it. He's not going to, because we need to be led by the Spirit. There's too much flesh now in the church. Everywhere. It's everywhere. But it's by His Spirit. Not by might, not by power, but by my Spirit, says the Lord of hosts. The Spirit is the one that's going to draw people to truth. The Spirit of truth is going to draw people to Christ where they can be fed properly, where their thirst will be quenched. And that's what He wants, though, before He does that. Are we ready? Are we ready? Please allow the Holy Spirit today to take inventory of your granary inside. All of us. Real quick. Heavenly Father, we love you. We thank you. Lord, we come before you. Examine us. Examine this preacher. Examine this church. Examine this platform. Examine the pulpit. Examine the pew. Lord, we ask that the dross be exposed in the mirror. Touch us today, O God. Prepare us, this earthen vessel, to receive what you want to bring to it. Thank you, Lord.
Your troubles fade.
discussion out. Verse 10. The life also of Jesus might be made manifest in our body. He says it again in verse 11. That the life also of Jesus might be made manifest in our mortal flesh. So that death works in us, but life in you. Our God, church, is a God of life, not a God of death. That's why we stand opposed to murder in the womb. He would tell Jeremiah, before I formed you in the belly, I knew you.